in around 7 months takes quite a toll. I used to have that much hair, and look what's happened. It's very appropriate to be here at the Chamber of Commerce for this speech about the Morrison government's fiscal strategy. The last 12 months has very much been a Team Australia effort. And your organisation, and particularly your membership, has done so much to keep our economy going. And it is our desire and our strategy to get the private sector to take the baton and to run with it. And so being here to talk at an ACCI event is highly appropriate. Can I acknowledge my good friend and partner in the budget process, Simon Birmingham? It's been great to work with him. He's been obviously an outstanding member of our team, and we've worked very closely and productively over the course of this budget preparation. To Bruce Bilson, who knows a thing or two about small business budgets and creating jobs, it's great to be here with you as well. Ladies and gentlemen, 1 year ago, our nation was in lockdown. We were staring into the economic abyss. 1.3 million Australians had been stood down or had lost their jobs. At the time, Treasury feared the unemployment rate could reach 15%, or over 2 million out of work. However, we were entering this crisis from a position of economic strength. The unemployment rate was 5.1%. Workforce participation was close to a record high. Welfare dependency at a 30-year low. We had returned the budget to balance for the first time in 11 years. Budget surpluses were forecast in each year across the forward estimates, and government debt was low by international standards. Australia's sound economic position enabled us to respond to COVID as required. Now, beyond all expectations, after the first recession in nearly 30 years, employment has not only returned to its pre-COVID level, it has surpassed it. There are more Australians in work today than ever before. Say that again. There are more Australians in work today than ever before. But we know that the job is not complete. We need to stick to the plan. So today I want to discuss the principles and the strategy that have successfully guided the Morrison government's decision to take so many economic measures to date, and the approach we will take during the recovery phase and beyond. Specifically, I want to talk about how our economic and fiscal strategy was designed to protect jobs and avoid the scarring of the labour market. How the upcoming budget will continue to prioritise job creation and drive the unemployment rate even lower. And how we will continue to ensure Australia's fiscal position remains strong and sustainable. At the outset of this crisis, we laid out a clear set of principles to guide our emergency response. Our response would be temporary. It would be targeted. It would be proportionate to the shock, and it would use existing systems where it was appropriate to do so. And all our efforts would be focused on keeping as many Australians as possible in work. We were determined to avoid the high cost of prolonged unemployment from past recessions. In the 1980s recession, the unemployment rate rose from around 5% to over 10% and took 8 years to recover. In the 1990s recession, the story was the same, with unemployment rising from around 6% to over 11% and taking nearly 10 years to recover. In stark contrast, following this recession, we are on track for the unemployment rate to recover in around just 2 years. From the outset, we were determined to limit the damage to the labour market. This is why the government responded with an unprecedented level of support to protect vulnerable households, save Australian businesses and jobs. We've committed more than $250 billion in direct economic support, including JobKeeper, the single largest and most successful economic support program in Australia's history. The assistance was overwhelmingly temporary and front-loaded, with three quarters of the support to be delivered in the first 2 years. This ensured the support was delivered when it was needed most and did not structurally weaken our budget position. Importantly, fiscal and monetary policy worked in tandem to support our economy. Just as the government stepped up to provide unprecedented levels of fiscal support, so too the Reserve Bank moved swiftly to ensure monetary policy was highly accommodative. As a direct result of our actions, Australia has experienced a smaller fall in economic activity than any major advanced economy. And we are the first major advanced economy to see both hours worked and employment return to pre-pandemic levels. Australia is now set to avoid what many feared would be another lost generation to long-term unemployment. In the October budget, as the economy was showing early signs of recovery, we published our fiscal and economic policy strategy that was revised. The strategy was set out in two phases. The initial phase of the strategy, the COVID-19 economic recovery plan, continued our core focus on achieving a strong economic recovery, getting people back into work and avoiding the scarring of the labour market. The second phase focused more on securing our long-term fiscal sustainability by growing the economy in order to stabilise and then reduce gross and net debt as a share of GDP. When introducing the fiscal strategy last year, I said that the first phase would focus sharply on boosting business and consumer confidence and promoting jobs and growth throughout the economy. That the priority must be to secure a strong and sustained economic recovery and drive the unemployment rate down. And that the first phase would remain in place until the unemployment rate was comfortably below 6%. This guidance provided a marker on the road to recovery. It provided a clear signal to households and businesses that the government would not withdraw support prematurely in support of fiscal consolidation. With 8 out of 10 jobs in the private sector, transitioning to private sector-led growth and job creation was central to this strategy. Private sector growth is the essential ingredient in maintaining a strong economy and a sustainable position over the longer term. You can't have one without the other. Large-scale government support is no substitute for sustainable jobs in the private sector. The strategy also provided us with the flexibility we needed to keep responding to rapidly changing economic circumstances and the uncertainty that a pandemic brings. Throughout this crisis, the government has adapted and tailored its policies as the economic environment has required, be it the extension and tapering of JobKeeper, temporary regulatory relief, or targeted support packages for sectors and regions in need. This has been a critical feature of our response. Fiscal support to the Australian economy peaked at 3.7% of GDP in the September quarter last year, or around $70 billion. By the March quarter this year, it had more than halved to 1.4%, or around $30 billion. Even as fiscal support was reduced, the economy continued to recover and jobs continued to come back. Emergency support programs like JobKeeper had to come to an end. It was the right decision for the economy, for the labour market, and, of course, for the budget. Despite many doomsday predictions as to what JobKeeper's end would mean for the economy, early data indicates the labour market has remained resilient and has continued to strengthen. Over the fortnight to the 16th of April, immediately following the conclusion of JobKeeper, the number of people on income support has actually fallen by approximately 46,000 people. And as the JobKeeper program concluded in March, job ads rose to reach an all-time high and the number of job seekers for every vacancy fell to its lowest level in over a decade. While this is encouraging, we are not complacent. We recognise that the COVID-19 pandemic is far from over. And we know that some businesses and sectors are still doing it tough, and that is why the Morrison government's economic support is continuing. I would now like to turn to the upcoming budget. This will be another pandemic budget being delivered in the midst of a once-in-a-hundred-year pandemic and just 7 months after the last budget. The budget will lay out the next phase of Australia's economic recovery plan to grow our economy so we can deliver the jobs and guarantee the essential services Australians rely on while also keeping Australians safe. We should all be encouraged that the economic recovery is on track and ahead of schedule. Unemployment in March has fallen to 5.6%, which is below the most optimistic Treasury forecasts and below the forecast of 7.5% in my EFO for the March quarter. This represents around 200,000 more Australians in work than we were expecting just over 4 months ago. There is now strength across a range of indicators that suggest ongoing momentum in the broader Australian economy. Consumer confidence has risen to beyond its pre-pandemic level and now sits at an 11-year high. Business conditions are at the highest on record. Capital investment intentions for the next 12 months are at their strongest since 1994. Investment in machinery and equipment like vehicles and harvesters was up 8.1% in the most recent December quarter data, the largest quarterly increase in 7 years. All very positive signs. Nevertheless, we continue to face enormous uncertainty on both the health and the economic fronts. Around the world, more than 800,000 people are contracting COVID every day. Global deaths have reached over 3 million. We know that the virus is evolving and new strains are emerging. And while the vaccine rollout is progressing both here and abroad, it still remains at a relatively early stage. Many health systems, including in India, have been completely overwhelmed. So as long as the virus remains a threat, we face enhanced risks to the global and to the domestic economy. Despite the strength in our domestic economic recovery, the unemployment rate is not comfortably below 6%. Our international borders remain largely closed. Australia is experiencing the lowest population growth in a century. Interest rates are close to zero. These are unusual and uncertain times. For these reasons, we remain firmly in the first phase of our economic and fiscal strategy. We need to continue to work hard to drive the unemployment rate lower. And that is what the budget in just under 2 weeks' time will do. We will not move to the second phase of our fiscal strategy until we are confident that we have secured our economic recovery. We want to first drive the unemployment rate down to where it was prior to the pandemic and even lower. And then when we get there, to ensure it's sustained. The last time Australia had a sustained period of unemployment below 5% was between 2006 and 2008, just prior to the GFC. Before that, you need to go all the way back to the 1970s. There are a number of important reasons why our fiscal strategy remains focused on driving unemployment even lower. Against the backdrop of a highly uncertain global economic environment, it's prudent to continue to support the economy and then ensure our recovery is locked in. Moreover, monetary policy is heavily constrained. Unlike prior to the crisis, the Reserve Bank has reduced scope to lower interest rates to drive down unemployment and to drive up wages. This has placed more of the burden on fiscal policy. And estimates of the NARU, or the rate of employment below which inflation is expected to accelerate over time, has come down. The Treasury will today release a technical working paper on the NARU, as well as a paper on labour force participation. As has been foreshadowed, they now estimate that the NARU sits between 4.5% and 5% lower than their previous estimate of 5%. The lower estimate of the NARU means a lower unemployment rate will now be required to see inflation and wages accelerate. In effect, both the RBA and the Treasury best estimate is that the unemployment rate will now need to have a 4 in front of it to deliver this outcome. We want more people in jobs, and we want people in better paying jobs. That is what our fiscal strategy is designed to achieve. Of course, in the long run, we know that the key to sustainably delivering higher real wages is through lifting productivity. That is why the government will continue to pursue a range of reforms and investments to boost productivity and set Australia up for the future. This includes measures to be outlined in this year's budget in the area of skills, infrastructure, tax, energy, the digital economy, and deregulation, to name just a few. We are making the necessary investments to seize the opportunities that will set Australia up for the future, create jobs, and lift wages over the long run. Finally, I would like now to turn to the important issue of fiscal sustainability. I want to be very clear. The Morrison government's core values have not changed. We remain committed to lower taxes, containing the size of government, budget discipline, and guaranteeing the essential services. We have the track record to prove it. COVID-19 has had an unprecedented impact on our levels of government debt, as it has all around the world. But using the government's balance sheet to limit the economic cost and the longer-term scarring of the labour market stemming from this crisis was certainly a responsible and a prudent decision. It was the fiscally responsible course of action. A stronger economy means a stronger and more sustainable budget. As I've outlined previously, there are consequences that flow from the crisis that somewhat delay the fiscal recovery. In particular, corporate tax receipts generally take some time to rebound following a downturn, due to the ability of businesses to deduct their losses. In contrast, much of the regular spending in the budget is less sensitive to movements in the economy and operates more like a fixed cost. Nevertheless, through the operation of the automatic stabilisers, a larger economy still generates relatively more tax receipts and requires less government expenditure on welfare payments. Let me give you one stylised example. As I said earlier, in March there were around 200,000 more Australians that were in work than we had expected as recently as MyEFO in December. 200,000 more Australians in work and off job seeker equates to about $3 billion less being paid out in direct income supports each year. It also generates, on average, over $2 billion in additional tax receipts each year. This is around a $5 billion turnaround to the budget. And these are just the direct effects. The indirect effects of a stronger economy and more people in work go well beyond this. Because of our policy interventions, Treasury has previously estimated that the economy will be 4.5% larger in 2021 and 5% larger in 21-22 than if we had not intervened. At that time, real GDP was not expected to regain its pre-pandemic level until the December quarter this year. All indications are that we have pushed through that milestone 9 months earlier. This stronger than expected economic recovery means that our fiscal outlook in the 21-22 budget will be driven off a higher economic base than expected at last year's budget. This will assist us achieve our medium-term fiscal strategy of stabilising, then reducing gross and net debt as a share of GDP over time. This again reinforces the point that the best way to repair the budget is to repair the economy. This is further helped by our low interest rate environment, keeping our debt servicing costs low. Despite a substantial increase in gross debt, the MIEFO showed that the cost of servicing that debt is actually lower today than it was in 2018-19 as a result of these historically low interest rates. The government has also extended government borrowing to the longer end of the yield curve by issuing new lines of debt at 20-year and 30-year maturities. An increasing share of our total borrowing is now at longer-term maturities, making our debt repayments less sensitive to movements in the yields. Treasury's projections are that nominal economic growth will exceed the nominal interest rate for at least the next decade. That is, economic growth will more than cover the servicing of our debt interest payments. As a result, by growing our economy, we can maintain a steady and declining ratio of debt to GDP over the medium term as we continue to move towards balancing the budget. Looking further ahead, our challenge once we recover from this crisis is to again rebuild our fiscal buffers. We have done it before and we will do it again. But it won't be by undertaking any sharp pivots towards austerity. For fiscal consolidation to be sustainable, it should rely on gradual changes that are made over time and that provide the foundation for a growing, thriving economy. When we do transition to the second phase of the strategy, we will act in accordance with the principles that we have laid out, namely to focus on growing the economy in order to stabilise and reduce debt, to target a budget balance on average over the course of the economic cycle that is consistent with that debt objective. We will do this by controlling expenditure growth while maintaining the efficiency and the quality of government spending and guaranteeing the delivery of essential services. Supporting revenue growth through policies that drive growth while maintaining a tax to GDP ratio at or below 23.9%. Using the government's balance sheet to support productivity enhancing investments and by pursuing ongoing structural reforms that boost economic growth. Our economic and fiscal strategy provides the flexibility to respond to changing economic conditions while ensuring we remain focused on long-term fiscal sustainability. In conclusion, every Australian can be immensely proud of our nation's performance in response to COVID and that the part they have played. We have successfully suppressed the virus and our economy is recovering strongly. This is not the result of luck. Australians make their own luck. It has truly been a Team Australia moment, which has seen government, industry, and the public work closely and effectively together. But while Australia has fared better on the health and the economic front than nearly any other country in the world, there is no room for complacency, particularly as the virus remains a significant threat, as we have seen with recent events in India. That is why the budget in just under 2 weeks' time and our fiscal strategy as outlined today will continue to prioritise job creation as Australia's pathway to a stronger economy and to a stronger budget position. Ladies and gentlemen, our economic recovery plan is working, but the job is not done. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Treasurer, for a fantastic presentation. Now, if I could call on Dr. Ross Lambie, our Chief Economist, to conduct a Q&A with the Treasurer. I'll hand over to you now, Ross.
Thank you, Paul. Treasurer, I just want to take the opportunity of really thanking you and the government for the great economic management we've had today. As Jenny commented earlier on, we are very fortunate to be where we are. And from what you said in your speech, we really sort of welcome the focus and the direction the government is looking to take from here. You mentioned about productivity, and you mentioned about the importance of productivity, and that's something that's pretty dear to ACCI's heart, and it certainly features large in our pre-budget submission, the need for productivity growth. I guess I'd like to just start by asking you, business investment, business-led recovery, which is going to be important to the growth, particularly over the shorter term, but also out into the longer term. We're starting to see the benefits of measures such as the temporary full expensing, the instant asset write-off, a bit of a slow take-up, but totally understandable given business confidence had to come through. And as you rightly point out, business conditions are looking very, very favourable. What is the role for these sort of measures longer term in terms of supporting the economic growth that we're going to need?
Well, as you know, in the budget, we had announced last year the immediate expensing provision for businesses with a turnover of less than $5 billion. And that was seen to cover around $200 billion of investment. And the idea is that that doesn't really hurt the budget structurally or in the sort of medium term. It's a bring forward of spending by business. And so we get the double benefit. You get a more productive economy from that investment, but you also get the job creation that comes with it. That was in place for a couple of years, and it was combined with the loss carry back measure, which allowed businesses that may have made a loss to offset that against previous taxes on profits, taxes paid on profits. Those measures seem to be working. I referenced the CapEx expectations of business being high, but also the December quarter of an increase of about 8% in business investment. So those measures seem to be doing what we intended it to do. And of course, we always look for new opportunities to drive further business investment. I think what business is looking for is some certainty and stability, because we know that there's $240 billion that's been accumulated on both household and business balance sheets that was not there this time last year. That's money that's been saved, that's money that the government has spent, that's been accumulated, and it's going to be really important for the sustainability of the recovery that that money is spent over time. And so for business to make investments and use that money that's been accumulated, they look for stability and certainty. And so hopefully today's speech provides that pathway going forward and that certainty for business. Because for Simon and I and the Prime Minister and the rest of the government, a key focus to Australia's economic recovery plan is for the private sector to take the baton and to run with it. Because 8 out of every 10 jobs are in the private sector. And we want business to be feeling confident to go and invest, to hire, to innovate, and to grow. And so this budget will be seeking to build on announcements in last year's budget, designed to do that. With respect to productivity, this is not only an Australian challenge, this is a global challenge. There's lots of factors that are at play here. We're more of a services-oriented economy. You're seeing a digital transformation, globalisation. All those factors have sort of played into how the economists are thinking about measuring productivity. But again, our infrastructure investments, our investments in skills and training, and what we're doing around the digital economy are all going to be designed to boost that productivity growth.
So a key part of the productivity growth too, and what you've highlighted in your speech, is jobs and skills. So we're in a situation now with international borders, still got restrictions on them. Barriers in terms of getting people and skills matched to businesses that need them. Are you focusing on those sort of barriers? And if so, what sort of incentives are needed to ensure we have that matching to allow that growth to actually be translated through to jobs?
Well, this was the motivation behind the National Skills Commission, which Adam Boynton is involved in, and has been a subject of much discussion between myself and the state treasurers, because there are some shared responsibilities around the skill system, and we share some of the payments, and we have agreements in place called NASWAD, which we're looking to put in place a successor to. And so we're entering into bilateral negotiations with states where issues like efficient pricing are being talked about, designed basically to get a better signal that matches up, as you say, what industry needs, what your membership needs, and what is coming out of our TAFEs and our other education institutions. We know there's going to be, we were seeing workforce shortages today, but we also know there's going to be future workforce shortages. One area that we're focused on is the care workforce. I mean, you saw 100,000 more people go onto the NDIS over the course of the last year. Who's going to be providing that important care and support? It's going to be trained people. And you can't just click your fingers and get that sizable workforce in place overnight. So too aged care. Our response is focusing on workforce, just as it is on governance and the sustainability of the sector. So there is some very important workforce needs across the economy, and we are going to have in the budget a series of measures that are designed to better match up the skills that are being produced with the needs of industry. And finally, one area where this is really important as well is with respect to the digital economy, cyber, for example, cyber technical skills. Everyone is going to have a great need for those technical skills going forward. And so we need to be able to produce in Australia those graduates with those skills.
Yes, and I think just on that, it is about acceleration in a lot of areas of the economy that we can capture, but ensuring that all the factors come together to truly allow us to capture that. So talking sort of in relation to skills and talent and the like, we know the government is wanting to attract the world's best talent to Australia, and let's be honest, if there is one place you'd like to live in the world at the moment that we all know and for quite some time, it is Australia. So how do we attract the world's best talent here, but also attract them and get the job